I'm Detective Sergeant in the Sheriff's Office. I'm one of the guys working this case way back when, okay, along with him. So what we'd like to do is we'd like to sit down and talk to you, just give me a minute, okay?
Yep.
You need any water? Would you like any water? You need to go to the bathroom?
Okay, yeah, why don't we, yeah.
Yes, we'll do that now. If you want a water or anything after that.
Get a little water.
Okay, you let me know. Can you take her to the restroom, please?
I'll leave this blank in the bathroom.
That's fine. What, can we get her into now?
Yeah.
Alright. Cool.
I got you.
If you're gonna do that, if you don't mind, open it.
There's that. And there's that.
Time to get back.
Do you think you're gonna follow her?
Just see in a couple minutes, alright?
Okay, brand new water for you.
Can I wrap myself?
Yes. Go ahead.
Thank you, Joey.
Yeah.
Cold in there.
You cold too?
Yeah.
Cold in.
Cold in the hole?
I don't have mine anywhere else, but.
Me neither right now. I'm still cold.
It's just cold from being outside.
Cold.
Yeah. After a while.
Yeah. Yes, it is 9:30 PM.
So it's one AM reserve where I came from.
Thanks, Joe. Make sure that's good.
Okay.
Alright. It was a little chilly in there, isn't it? Chris, again, he introduced himself, but this is Mike.
Sergeant to the Sheriff's Office.
Alright.
I'm sorry, I didn't get your name.
Sergeant Mike. Call me Mike. How about that? If that's okay.
Sergeant Mike.
Yes, is that okay with you?
I've known him for a very long time, and he may not be quite as nice as me, but he's still a really nice guy.
I can tell.
Okay.
Chris, what we do is we record everything, so I'm just letting you know this thing's running.
Okay.
Now, before we even get started, okay, again, like I said, from way back when, in 2007, I was working in this case, okay, and there's been a lot of time in between, alright?
11 years.
Yes, exactly. But what I want to talk to you about before we even get started is I want to make sure you understand that we're going to treat you fairly, okay? I'm not sure about, Brazil and how things go down there, but up here we're going to do things exactly how we're supposed to, okay? And I'm sure Bill has told you that.
Yes,
okay?
Yes.
Now, it's my understanding from what I hear that while you were on the plane right up here, you gave these guys a statement about what happened. Is that?
Yeah, partial.
Partial,
yes.
Statement, okay, great. Now, what I want to ask you now is, and I want to make sure that you don't have to talk to us, okay? That's first and foremost. I would love to hear your side of the story, okay? But what I need to do is I need to make sure that you understand what your rights are, okay? Now, you had a lawyer down in Brazil, is that correct? It was helping you with this case down there, okay? You know, obviously, he's not up here. We want to talk to you. We can talk to you without a lawyer, which is your choice.
It doesn't matter to me.
So you're willing to talk to us without a lawyer?
Yes.
And you're sure of that? Because
I have nothing to hide.
Okay, great. But I just understand something. As much as I can't wait to hear what you have to say, it's more important for me to make sure that you understand what you're
doing. I do understand my rights.
Okay. You understand that, say, you've been charged with murder.
I have the right to stay silent. I know that.
Okay.
If I want to talk, it doesn't bother me to talk to you.
Okay. great, and we're gonna get to that. You do understand, just one more question. You do understand that when you get arraigned, you know what your arraignment is, when you actually get formally, you go see the judge about the charge you've been charged with, murder? They're gonna assign you a lawyer. And you're willing to talk to me now without that lawyer around?
Doesn't bother me.
Okay, wonderful.
So I will tell you, Chris, I haven't told him everything that we talked about.
Yeah, because you haven't had the time.
That was an 8-hour flight. We put a lot of time in that airport. So.
And I haven't told you 10% of it.
This is the paperwork that I told you. Remember when Tony and I were on the plane talking to you? And we said that we would have, there are some things that we had to do that we couldn't ask you questions.
Yes.
So this is the paperwork that has to be done before we can ask any of those follow-up questions.
Yes, I understand.
Okay. Again, you'll see this is much different than how they do things down there. Everything is.
Yeah.
Everything is out in the open and above board.
Yeah.
And nobody here is trying to trick you.
Yeah,
that's the one thing we need to make sure of that. We are not here to trick you, okay? We are here to make sure. You know, I don't know, again, I'm kind of interested to learn how things are in Brazil, but
we can ask me any question.
Believe me, I'm going to ask you so many questions that you're going to be tired of me by the time.
No, I
will tell you this, from the time that we spent together, it's very important to her, correct me if I'm misstating this, that you fill in the blanks, because she was reading a lot of things in the news and seeing the things that were reported, and she wants to fill in those blanks of the things that weren't correct. Is that fair? Is that kind of how this thing started?
Yeah.
Okay.
Awesome. How about we do this? Can you read ranked English language?
Yes.
Okay. What I'm going to do is, these are your constitutional rights under Miranda. Okay? This section right here, put those on, please. This section right here, from here to here, those are your constitutional rights. And what I'll do is I'll read those to you, and I'll ask that you follow along.
Sure.
You'll see at the end of each sentence, there's a blank space. What I want you to do is put your initials there if you understand
it.
If you don't understand it, ask me, and I'll be more than happy to explain it.
Sure.
Once we get through that, when we get down here, this paragraph is called your waiver of rights. And again, I'll read that. But what that basically says is that you understand what your rights are, you're willing to wait at this time and talk to
them.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So you take this pen and follow along with it. Before we ask you any questions, you must understand your rights. If that's true, initial there. You have the right to remain silent, which you already told me you knew.
Mm-hmm.
Anything you say can be used against you in court.
Yes.
You have the right to talk to a lawyer for advice before he asks you any questions, and to have him with you during questioning.
I waive that.
You waive that, is that what you
said? Yeah, I don't have a problem with that.
Okay. If you cannot afford a lawyer, one will be appointed for you before any questioning if you wish. If that's true, initial there. Decide to answer questions now without a lawyer present. You still have the right to stop answering at any time. You also have the right to stop answering at any time until you talk to a lawyer. Now, this is the waiver of rights. I have read, or have had read to me, the statement of my constitutional rights, and I understand what my rights are. I'm willing to make a statement and answer questions. I do not want a lawyer at this time. I understand and know what I am doing. No promises or threats have been made to me, and no pressure or coercion of any kind have been used against me. I therefore waive my rights and agree to make a statement. If that is true, please sign there.
Yeah. That doesn't mean that I will not have a lawyer.
You know, you will. Basically, this just means you'll talk to us right now without a lawyer present.
Sure.
You will get a lawyer assigned to you if you cannot afford one. Absolutely. And that will probably happen as soon as tomorrow. Years ago. Today's date is Wednesday, January 17, 2018. The time is 9:36 p.m. Speaking with Detective Sergeant Mike Dinucci with the Trumbull County Sheriff's Office. We're currently in the investigative division of the Sheriff's Office. Also present in the room from the U.S. Marshal's Office, Bill Bolden. Bill, for voice recognition purposes, please state your name.
My name is Bill Bolden. I'm a senior inspector with the U.S. Marshal's.
Great, thank you. And we are sitting here with, please state your name.
Claudia Christina Hoerig.
Claudia Christina Hoerig. Now, Claudia, you were here.
Chris.
She likes Chris. I'm going to call you Chris. You were here right now. You've been charged, what, almost 11 years ago, you were charged here with the murder of your husband. His name was Karl Hoerig, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, now, in the meantime, you just now came back on a plane from Brazil,
yes,
that true?
Yes, that's true.
Okay. Now, where you were living in Brazil, do you have an address down there where you were living?
Yeah.
What would the address be?
CLSW 504.
I've been there for 2 days, that's all the address. It's hard to...
That's quite an address.
Yes.
Chris, what's your date of birth?
August 23, 1964.
That makes you how old?
53.
And you are a U.S. citizen. Do you have a social security number? You know what your social is?
1-2-7-7-6-4-5-9-9. Wow.
That is an amazing number. How did you prove that? She's impressed me with numbers. She's impressed me with numbers the whole trip. She's a math person. She's a numbers person.
That's
amazing.
That's shocking. I'm shocked myself now.
Now, before we get into, I'm anxious to learn about what happened and how you ended up in jail down in Brazil. But we'll get to that. That's kind of towards the end.
We've been talking for a month then.
We're gonna be talking for a while. Don't you worry. I got coffee over there, so I'll be good. But I kind of want to start at the beginning. I want to go back to March 15th, 2007.
Okay, you're gonna start from the end.
The beginning of the end. Yes.
It's gonna start backwards.
I think, in fairness, what you had already talked to Tony and I about on the plane. Yeah. I think that would be a very good place to start, because that you hit a lot of the most important things that you wanted.
I jumped all over the place, so I don't know if I would be able to repeat and help me.
Well, here's what will happen. You can jump all over the place. You're allowed to do that. And then what we'll do is we'll try to rein you back in. We'll try to bring it back in and try to make sense of it. The way I find over the years is I like to talk, if we talk in order, like say the day that this happened, and kind of move forward from there, that seems to jog the memory fairly well. But if you can tell me whatever you want to tell me, and then we'll go back and we'll go through it. What would be easier for you? How about that?
Bill.
Yes. I know how hard
I want to be fair to the family, but I don't want to be unfair to myself. If I say only a few things and I don't say the whole thing,
right,
I'm gonna look very bad.
I think that what I would like you to do, and this is entirely up to you, just talk about the things that you talked about with us before, the things that you were already comfortable with, the things that you told Tony and I on the airplane, okay? And then once you're done doing that, questions we will ask you. If you're comfortable answering them, you can. If you don't want to, you don't have to. But I think for me,
I only tell the things that I did and I don't say the things that he did, that doesn't mean
that
very little good.
I agree. But the things
I was telling him that I didn't want to say all the bad things that he did to me, because I didn't want his family, which are very good people, to know the real person that he was, because I like those people, they're very good people, And they don't know everything about that man.
I understand. Here's what I'll tell you about that.
And if I tell you, oh yeah, this is what I did, this, but I don't tell you what led into this, that's my concern. Either tell you everything, I'm still confused about
it. Chris, here's what I'll tell you. The stage is yours. You tell me, tell us whatever you want to tell us. Okay, we're not going to control or put words in your mouth. Whatever you feel comfortable telling us.
You heard my stories. I was emotional when I told you the stories. I don't completely remember what parts in the sequence in which I told these things.
Would it help?
You could help me.
Would it help you if I ask you some of the questions based on what we talked about earlier?
Yes.
We can start with that.
Yes. Because see, one thing is for me to talk the way I talk.
You were more relaxed.
I'm not so relaxed.
I understand.
So my memory shuts down.
It's a little scary.
It's a little scary. Because I feel like I'm under pressure to explain things. I didn't feel that way on the plane.
Right. And you're not going to be under any pressure. I'm not going to talk to you any differently now than we did on the airplane.
It's very hard not to feel under pressure.
It's scary.
Only because I feel like if I only get the chance to say this much, and I don't say the whole thing, I'm gonna incriminate myself, make myself look like a terrible person, and I'm not gonna say why.
The why is important, that part
that I said that I didn't want to say to protect the family from knowing.
And remember,
it's very hard for a parent to know, you have children, to know bad things about your child, isn't it?
It is.
I don't want to hurt that family, you know, they've been hurt, they already lost their son, and I don't want them to know certain parts of their son's personality, because I can't bring him back. It will not change the outcome of my of this case. I'm certain that I'm gonna get
convicted.
I'm prepared for that, and to me it doesn't matter anymore. I feel I'm 53, but I don't feel like 53. I feel like 103. So to me, you know what, 103 year old has expectations of doing what with her life. You know,
I'm gonna help you here a little bit
because
remember when we were talking
all over the place.
When we were talking on the plane, Tony and I both said that we would not lie to you. We had a big conversation on the plane. And we did tell you that the things that you said to us, we can't keep secret. You know what I mean? We have to report what was said. So really all I would like to do right now is talk a little bit about the things that you told us on the plane. Because you did say some things that were very important that none of us knew, and if we didn't know until you told us. And I think that's a very important part of your story, and it's a very important part of the entire story about what happened.
Can you make a piece of paper? Because I feel better organized with a piece of paper.
You want to write something?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me ask you this.
Not write this, just scratch. Having a piece of paper in front of me and a pen helps me out.
Now, let me ask you this, Chris. We can do it the way Bill's talking about doing it, if that's easier for you. What if I just ask you to explain, tell you, when we got to the house, this is what we saw. Can you tell us how this happened? Would that be something?
No, that's not how I want to tell you.
You don't want to do that? Okay.
No.
Right, how do you want to tell me this story?
I think
what is important is the couple of things that you said that led up to what happened that day. The things that you said when you were talking about how things happened that day, and that it wasn't something that That, yes, we do. So you, let's do this. Remember, when we were on the airplane, we were talking. You, Carl, took you to the hospital. Remember, that's kind of how we started talking about things. Took you to the hospital for a mental evaluation because you had tried to kill yourself with that or thought about it.
Well, I think that's a very summarized version.
Right.
The story is
much long, yes.
Very long. We met through the internet.
Mm-hmm. On a website.
On a website.
What was that website called? The match.com?
I think so, yeah. And we dated for 2 months. 2 months. Oh my glasses. Over the internet. He found me. He was in New York. He was here. He found me. And he put a lot of pressure on me to date him. I said, but why would I want to date a woman in New York? You know, I said, no problem, because I can, I'm a pilot, and I can work anywhere in the U.S. that I want, and there is a base that is about 1 hour from New York, and I can ask them to transfer me. This was from the Air Force. I can transfer, can ask to be transferred to there. I don't remember exactly what I said, but he said, I can prove to you that I can be, just tell me what day you want me to be there, and I'll be there. It's, I think I told him today, or tomorrow, the next day, and he was there.
Showed up. Did he fly up there?
Yeah.
Showed up. You met him that day?
I met him that day, and I was like, wow, this man is not mine.
Right?
Yeah, I was impressed. Yeah, I was impressed. And he was a pretty good-looking guy. He showed up so well-dressed up and some hot pants, some look like leather material. He was very well-dressed. And I said, this man is very interesting. He's good-looking. Why would he want it so bad? And then I would have to tell you the long story. Well, he trapped me. He wants to marry me at any cost. And
right there that day?
That day.
Wow. Didn't you say you were dating for like 2 months?
We dated for 2 months.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you were talking about getting married the first day?
The first day.
Wow.
Yeah. But I was in New York. We dated long distance. He was in Ohio. We dated over the phone. I went there once. No, he went there to New York once. Then I came to Ohio once. And then our next date was in Belle Island. There's an island here.
Put in Bay?
Yes, put in Bay. And that day, I thought that man was crazy. He had made an engagement party. He invited all his friends there. And he prepared an engagement party for us without telling me that he was getting engaged to me. And everybody said to me, oh, Chris, congratulations. And I was like, yeah, but I didn't know what they are congratulating me for.
Was my engagement. Give you a ring?
No, never gave me a ring, ever. This was our party, our engagement party.
Wow.
And that day he took us to Put in Bay, his brother, Paul, drove us to the ferry.
Mm-hmm. The buggy thing over there.
And they were talking my wedding party. I didn't know it was my wedding party that I'm talking about.
He planned the wedding without you.
Yeah. It was bizarre. But I was 40 years old. This is the man that everybody ever dreamed of.
quick, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That was, that's what started everything. We started talking about that, and we were all looking at each other just amazed. That was.
Usually it's the other way around. Usually the women plan it real fast. That's usually the way it happens.
No, no. He would put a lot of pressure into me. And the thing is that he didn't pay for a thing. He always forgot his wallet. Always. I paid for all the trips. My trip to go to Ohio from New York.
What did you do for a living? Okay.
I'm an accountant.
No.
Yes. So I paid for my move to bring in all my furniture here. I paid for all the food in the house. I paid for our wedding. I paid for everything in the house. So after we got married, he surprised me. His 16-year-old son that lived in, North Carolina,
right,
with his mother,
mm-hmm,
he brought his son to live with us. So we got married on June 30th of 2005. And we went to Las Vegas. When I came back, when we came back from Las Vegas, his son was in his house. I didn't know him. Living. Okay, so I wasn't working. I spent the month of July at home. I wasn't working. In August, He left for a course in Texas. It was a 3 to 4 month course because he worked full time for the Air Force, and he decided to, and he didn't want to work full time for the Air Force anymore. He wanted to work for Southwest, full time for Southwest, part time for Southwest, part time for the Air Force. He used to make $120,000 with the Air Force. I don't know if it's true. I never saw his checkbook. I never saw his bank account. I never had a joint account with this man. I never saw $1 of this man's money. Never gave me any of his money. Nothing. I paid all the bills in the house. No, I didn't. He paid the electric and the mortgage. Everything else was with me. All the food, clothing for him. I bought his clothes, my clothes, his clothes, his son's clothes, everything, going out for dinner, everything else was on me. He paid for those two. So I remember he told me that with the Air Force he was going to make, $25,000 in Southwest, about 40. I think altogether was not more than $65,000.
It was quite a pay cut.
You know why? Because he wanted a lifestyle, crazy lifestyle. That's the part that I didn't want to expose him.
I know, but since you talked to me about it, it's something that has, you're doing good. And Mike is just as nice as Tony, and we're sitting here, and I think it's important. This is an important part of your story.
He wanted a crazy lifestyle of doing all kinds of perverted stuff. Men, women, everything. And for you to have an idea what lifestyle he liked, he was addicted to a TV show called Miles High. If you look it up on YouTube, it's about pilot school, and he had left that lifestyle. He wasn't a faithful man, and he had sex with men and women. He was, a man that one thing.
And he told you this? I think your idiot's more favorite.
Chris, I'll tell you, you just got through the hardest part, okay? So you just got, when we were talking earlier, that was the part that was hard for you. So you're doing you've given us a very good picture.
Listen, this has no bearing in whether I'm going to be convicted or not. I will be convicted. So why am I going to hurt that family knowing this?
Do you remember what we said on the airplane? That even if it's a bad story, they want to know what happened and why. Everybody wants to know. And you know, there's only one version of the story out there because you haven't
really sure yet. Here's the way I like to tell people to sit in your chair right there. You get one chance to tell your story. And this is it. I can't control what you tell me, but I'm going to tell you this is the one time you're going to get to sit here. We are not going to be able to do this again. Me and you are not going to sit across from each other at this table again. This is your one chance to make it all count. And that's what you need to remember. I know you've said it more than enough that you're not trying to like the family, you don't want to hurt the family.
Because they're alive and he's dead.
Right.
My
answer to you is, the truth speaks volumes. There is nothing like the truth. Whether we like the truth or not, we have to deal with it. You follow what I'm saying? And that's the way, I think your best interest is telling your story however you want to tell it. But this is your
case. Yeah. This story that I'm telling you, who's going to hear it? Judge?
Absolutely. If.
Me.
A lot of things can happen. Just because you, and I'm going to tell you this, and I'm being completely honest with you, just because you tell us things in this room today doesn't mean the family is going to read these reports or see this. They're not going to hear everything that you tell. At some point in time, some of these things may be discussed, but the family is not going to be sitting there when you're going to be told to them right away, okay?
Right away, but at one point they will.
At some point in time, they may hear some of these things, and again, like I said, I already have to report the things that I heard because that's my obligation, that's my duty. So I'm going to have to report those things, so I would much rather, with Mike sitting here, hear them from you so we get it right.
Plus, hearing it from you probably helps like help people understand what ended up happening.
You really enlightened me when you were talking, and I really want him to hear that. I really want him to hear what you told me.
Yeah, I have to because the story is very long, has many parts to it. I have to summarize it because otherwise we're going to be here.
I'll tell you what, if you summarize it, then we'll go back and hit on the highlights. How about that?
So the month of July we spent together. We married on June 30th, and we spent together July. Not really. As soon as we got married in Las Vegas, I paid for the whole trip. I paid for everything. I didn't want to be married to him anymore.
Right after you got married.
Right after we got married. So we went back to New York. I went back to New York to my job. And because I lied to my boss, and I told her, I was so embarrassed to tell her that I was going to marry a man like that I just met. I was so embarrassed, so I wasn't even sure it was going to, I was so pressured into doing this. At some point, I figured that I was going to tell him, let's wait. But I wound up doing that, but I felt very bad, and I went back to New York, back to my work, didn't tell anything to my boss. I continued to work, and 2 weeks after I was there, he pressured me every day. He said, well, I gave you enough time for you to tell your boss that you're married. If you don't tell her that you're married, I'm going to call her right now, and I'm going to tell her that you married me a couple weeks ago. I said, please don't do that. Don't do that because it's going to hear it from me. I want to give her my version. So he gave me that day for me to tell my boss. So I walked into her office and I told her what happened. So then I had no more job. Ohio, and he said, I'm going to change because he treated me very, very screaming. Oh my God, kill those ants. He said, you never scream in that house again. I don't like screaming because you know what a soldier does when they hear screaming? They react. They so start talking to me in a way that he never talked to me before. I saw kindness here in him before, then all of a sudden he was a different person. He scared the life out of me. So I told him I'm going back to New York. Well, that was February of 2007. That was almost 2 years later.
Oh, 2 years later.
Two
okay.
2 years later.
So you were working there for a while. You were at the county. You were at the county firm. And what led up you to go to the hospital that night?
Let me tell you about the pregnancy first.
Okay. Please.
So in July, we were newly. Newlywed, right? And his son was living in with us, and he, in August he decided to leave to go to Texas to take a flight course to work with Southwest, and he left his son with me for 3 to 4 months.
Now, is this at the house in Newton Falls?
Yeah.
Okay.
His son never saw me. Before I never saw him, he didn't know it was a serial killer. He left his 16-year-old son with me. I thought that was weird. Not only that he left me, we had just gotten married. He decided to leave and he left his son with me. So that was very weird. And he left it, no money for food, for anything. I had to take his son to school every day. I had a child all of a sudden, 16-year-old child. I had to take him to school every day. I had to pay for his school. His clothes, he had no jacket, cold jacket, nothing. I had to take care of that boy, and I did. And in the beginning, he didn't like me because he didn't know me. But we only had each other. We became close. But at some point, he wanted to leave. And Carl started blaming me for his son to want to go back to his mother. And I said, no, you're not going to put that blame on me because I have a tape that I recorded his son telling me that he wasn't going back to his mother because of me, but because of what Carl did that abandoned him with a stranger. And I had a lot of recording about my relationship between me and Carl on my hard drive in my computer that was in Newton Falls. The police has that. That shows his character, all the things that he did to me, how he screamed at me, how he cursed at me, how he abused me. That is all in there. Because in my first marriage, that was married subscription to a site called Hogtide. Do you know what that is?
I'll tell you, I do.
You do?
I looked that site up way back in 2007.
You did that to me.
You want to explain it?
You forced me into... Oh my God. Those are the things that he did to me. He forced me to do that. He forced me to play dead. He would only have an orgasm if I played dead. If I moved one muscle, he would lose his erection. So, in the beginning, when we were dating, we didn't have full sex because he wouldn't get any erection because he wasn't playing his weird games with me. Remember that he went one time to New York and came two times to Ohio, so he tried to have sex the first time. We couldn't because he didn't get any erection. Then later on, I started using
Viagra,
right? But he didn't tell me. I found that in his little toiletry bag. So that was the second time. We were able to have sex because he took Viagra. He was very, I remember, he was very nervous with me, and he said, "You're not gonna leave me, right? Because I'm not a man enough for you, right? Because I couldn't perform." I said, no, I understand. Some men get nervous. He said, "It's because I had an accident when I served in country. I went once to Germany, met a woman there, and she sat on my penis, and she broke my penis. Now my penis has this lump in here, and that's the reason why I have all this dysfunction, and I'm suing the Air Force." This, you can see that he tried to sue the Air Force, because I have an enlarged prostate. And I have cancer, oh my God, I have cancer. It was very nice that I'm having cancer. And he tried to make up a lot of stories why he couldn't perform. But the truth is, he always started doing this hog tie to me after we got married. And I didn't like these games because, like I told you, I'm a very conservative woman.
Yes.
Right? So, but I went to leave him when it started with that. But then I said, gosh, I already lost my job. Start, accounting for all the stuff that I
left in New York, that you lost, that you gave up to move here.
I gave up,
yes. So you decided to keep trying.
I'm going to keep trying. Maybe I'm too old-fashioned. Maybe I should be more modern. Maybe I'll get used to it. So he beat me, and next to the bed, if the police was there, the police could see the bed was here. Here's the door to the bedroom, and here in this corner had box with things that he tortured me with, ropes, the whip. The vibrator had all those gadgets. So, he only had sex that way with me. Either he would tie me up, or he would I would have to play dead, or he would scratch his penis on my feet until he was bleeding. Was all weird stuff, and he made me walk around naked in the house on high heels all the time. It doesn't matter how cold it was, because even if you put the heat on, seen on Victoria's Secret.
Okay.
Those hills, you know, that you have a little pond,
mm-hmm.
right? Ridiculous stuff. I felt like a hug. And that's just not me.
Right.
So I had to, I couldn't put on socks, I couldn't put on pants, I couldn't put on a jacket. If we went out to eat, it was snowing out like this. I always had to wear open shoes, open toes, shoes, with, you know. So it was torture. He tortured me.
There's a fetish, obviously.
Yes, yes. Yeah, there is one little particular one that I don't feel comfortable telling you.
And you don't have to, okay?
There's one very, very bad one.
And if you don't have to tell us anything, you're not comfortable telling us. I think at this point, everybody, we have a very good picture that there were some fetishes and there were things that you were uncomfortable with.
Yeah. And it was that or not.
And it was that or not.
There was that or hell. Help.
So,
cursing. He never only beat me up once. But that was the day that happened. Yeah, that was the only time that he beat me up. But he would abuse me verbally. I have something to tell you. I'm frightened. He went crazy. He said, I never want to be a father. I never want to have children. Because you're going to ruin your body. I love your body the way it is. You're going to get stretch marks. Like his first wife got a lot of stretch marks. And I don't want that. You're not going to do this to me. I want a wife. I don't want a mother. I don't want a children. I want a wife. And I said, but I'm 40 years old. I can't. I'm not going to get an abortion. You will get an abortion. So I went to see him in Texas. I made a trip there. He didn't let me talk about this deprivation technique on me. So and before that, over the phone, he would call me all neurotic, crazy. You gotta get an abortion. You gotta get an abortion. You gotta get an abortion. So he would talk to me all the time about that. So I like I was going crazy. And when he came home, just been a weekend or a few days, I don't remember, a week, got a week off for a few days, he wouldn't let me sleep. And I begged him, I can't, you're killing me. So he would keep me up and he would stay on bed, sitting on bed. And I would lay down and fall asleep. He would wake me up. Wake up, wake up. So he would do that all the time. And I got sick. After a few days, my body just couldn't take it anymore. I got sick from the mental pressure, from the mental torture, from sleep deprivation. I wind up in the middle of the night. I felt pain, and I said, I don't know what this pain is. And all of a sudden, I had blood all over. And then he took me to a hospital. And I did the ultrasound, and they saw you are losing the baby. We're going to try to save it, but we don't know if we're going to be able to save the baby. But she did the ultrasound and said, I don't see the fetus anymore. The sac is empty. Go home and rest, this and that. But then when I got home, the blood, and I stuck my hand with the fetus. I was very emotional. Took the fetus and put inside a little glass jar, and I showed him. He didn't want to see it, and I put it in the freezer. I said, I'll put it in the freezer because I want to bury it. I want to bury the fetus, and he went into the freezer and threw away the fetus. So cold, he threw away the fetus. I want to keep it, whatever, bury it in the yard. meant so much to me, it meant nothing to me. And then I went into the hospital to do the, to clean up the uterus.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I went into surgery. So I don't know the name of the hospital because I'm not familiar with names and I would not remember anyway, it's been 11 years. But I'm sure that my insurance, that was from his insurance, has all that paperwork. They could, you could see that my story is true. So so after 3 or 4 months, his son went back to his mother, and our time together became a little bit better. I was more used to his abuse, but he did a lot of bad things to me. He wouldn't, I wasn't allowed to talk. His mother doesn't talk. Just like his mother, a geisha, you know what a geisha is?
No, I don't.
Japanese is a woman that wears that dress and she serves the men. He wanted me to be like that. Very abusive of his first wife. She left him because of that. And she loved him. Daughter also confided in me that he was abusive to his mom, to his first wife, and she left him. She has for divorce, and that was the beginning of his depression because he had aspirations of becoming a politician, and he felt that after that he couldn't be a politician anymore because he didn't have the perfect house, the perfect wife. So, and then after that he had a second wife. There was a Peruvian woman that looked like me. That's why he married me, because I looked like his second wife. That he left her because she wanted to have children, and he simply took her out of his house and dumped her at the airport. So he ruined this woman's life. He got her to leave her job in France.
She couldn't know her. Did you talk to her?
He told, no, I don't know her. Those are stories that he told me. So, I don't remember the name. Carla, I remember her last name in a few minutes. So, he left her because she wanted to have children. He was abused toward women. He married this Carla, who was Peruvian, didn't speak any English, zero. But she was perfect because all he wanted was a body. He didn't want a person for him to talk to. And what he didn't like in me is because I spoke English. He wanted a woman to be like Carla, wife number two, that didn't speak any English, and that he could.
Why didn't he just keep her then?
Because she wanted to have children. And I
told him. What else to do with that?
Yeah. And I told him that I didn't want to have children. He loved them. And I did, but I became pregnant.
And becoming pregnant the first time, based on what we talked about earlier, that becomes a very important part of the story about what happened, because then, right? That becomes a very
That's the center
of everything. That becomes a very important part of the story.
So
you understand, based on our conversations earlier, that's a very important about what happened.
And I confided in my neighbor. Her name is Ella. Ella is the neighbor. She lives in the house across the street. He pregnant this man wants you to abort. He's now right about that. He doesn't have to fight to force you to an abortion. You gotta go back to New York. So I have this one person also to contribute to my story.
Very good. And that's all stuff that we can look into.
Yeah.
And we will. kind of keep.
Yeah.
Where do we want
but
to go now?
Then we had those 2 years, right? Of good. He was abusive, but at the same time, he would ask me for forgiveness. I always threatened to go back to New York, and he said he would change. He loved me. All I had to do was obey. If I obeyed, I would be happy. So he was telling me that he knew what was best for me. Just obey. Don't talk. Don't have an opinion. I had a rule, a list of rules of over almost 30 things that I couldn't do. I couldn't choose my food. I couldn't choose my clothes. I couldn't choose my shoes. I couldn't talk. I couldn't pick my what I was going to watch on TV. I was going to pick, couldn't pick my anything in the house. The house was his. I couldn't pick a furniture. I couldn't pick the color of the walls. Nothing. I had to be invisible and silent. So
after a while, that probably wears on you.
I couldn't. For this little time that you're talking to me, you know that I talk a lot.
Yeah, we've talked a lot today.
Yeah.
We've spent a lot of time together today.
Yes, exactly. I have an opinion on things.
Right. Did that stuff really kind of lead up to the depression that
yes.
it caused?
Yes, because I'm a woman that I can talk about medicine, I can talk about politics, I can talk about psychology, I can talk to you about the end of the world, whatever we want to talk about. I will talk to you about. I have a lot of interests. So I have a lot of things inside my head. I read a lot. If I watch TV, I'll watch the news. I consider myself a nerd. I never drank. I never had drugs. I don't have tattoos. I never went out with girlfriends. I'm from work to home.
You're very intelligent.
Very smart. We've talked
smart.
About that a lot on the plane.
Yes, very smart.
Oh, thank you very much. But he didn't appreciate that.
I do.
Well, that was a problem. That was my a defect. That was
the problem. Probably led to the depression.
Yes, yes. The abuse. The it's in the tapes on the computer. You see how he called me a bitch. Very bad words. Son of a bitch. Words that I don't speak. These words are not part of my vocabulary. I'm conservative. I'm a religious person. So I'm not modern. I don't like to go out partying. I like to take care of my home and I like to work. I always work at least 14 hours a day. And I always worked 7 days a week.
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't a problem. I worked in the CPA firm.
Right.
7 days a week.
And I know that when we were talking earlier that when you lost that job,
that was the most
devastating.
The end of the world to me. So we had 2 years good. I got pregnant a second time, about a year later.
So August 2006.
About 2006, I got pregnant again, and again he did the same thing to me, the same torture, and that was a very bad time for me because it started bothering him, because I was wrecking his body. My body, his body belonged to him. I started to gain weight, and that wasn't good.
Gaining weight as a result of the pregnancy?
Depression of losing a baby for the second time.
Okay.
I became
so
depressed.
So you lose the second baby because the same things were going on as happened the first time a year
exactly.
prior.
Okay. Yes. He thought I was purposely trying to get pregnant. I didn't even think I could get pregnant anymore because I didn't think I could get pregnant. getting pregnant, why wouldn't he use a preservative, right?
Right.
So he wasn't too, I was married and I didn't see a problem with that. So I did, because I didn't get pregnant, it was weird. I didn't get pregnant before him. But then I thought that was a thing that happened once, that wouldn't happen again because it didn't happen.
Now, like you told us earlier, there's medical records for the first time. Did you go to the doctor the second time?
No.
You
no.
Okay, so in 2006, there won't be medical records. In 2005, there should be.
There should be. Okay.
Yeah. All right. And after that, things start spiraling out of control.
Yeah, but we kind of were, he was in love all of a sudden, he was writing little letters, calling me all the time. Things got better after, I think we got used to each other the first year.
Because you didn't date long, so
yeah.
It took a while to get used to each other and get comfortable.
Exactly, and his son left, which is the two of us,
right.
We sort of dating, right? Then I got pregnant again, and he got very, very angry. And he
Are
thought I was setting.
The third time now? Or
no, no, the second time.
Second
and
now.
Then, he thought I was setting him up.
And is that kind of what he thought the third time?
No, I thought. Oh yeah, he was. He became very psychologically disturbed. Drinking a lot. He was not doing well in Southwest.
Now, what time frame are we talking about? After August 2006?
No, we are back in December of 2006. We're now 3 months before.
I was just making sure I understand, because I want to make sure that what I remember is right.
Because these are things that I'm saying now that I didn't.
The day that everything happened at the house.
I'm getting to that.
The first time you told him you were pregnant for the third time. Is that?
Yes, that was the first time.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure I remember that correctly.
That was the first time. Because I was afraid.
So that would have been March.
Was afraid. I was depressed because I was afraid that his reaction would be the same reaction
which it was. Right.
Which it was.
Yes.
It was even worse. Because he said he was going to adopt his daughter's baby.
You know what? Can you tell Mike, so kind of cover that again? Because I don't want to put words in your mouth. I can't sit here and tell you what you said. You know what I mean?
Yes.
You
wanted me to jump into that part.
No, I mean, I just wanted to make sure we were.
Yeah.
I wasn't putting words in your mouth.
Okay. Well, that day. I'll go into that day. That day was a Monday, and he got home about 9 or 10 in the morning.
Now, which day are you talking?
I didn't want to tell him over the phone, because he worked he stayed home one day and 3 days out of the house with the house. One day and a half, and 2 days and a half, he would fly. So I found out I was pregnant, and I got very nervous, so I became depressed. I already knew he was not going to accept the pregnancy. So I had a plan. If he doesn't want to accept this pregnancy, I'm going to kill myself. Because I'm already fat, I lost my job, I'm 42 years old, and I'm not going to have an abortion. There's nothing that's going to make me have an abortion, and he doesn't want a child. What am I going to do? I'm going to kill myself. So I had a plan to, I'm not going to tell you my plan yet. Let me just get into this pregnancy part. So he got home, and I already had this plan to commit suicide. He doesn't want the pregnancy. I'm going to kill myself. And then we talked. He got home. I had a coat, You know that my daughter's pregnant, and she's 8 months pregnant, and I'm gonna adopt her baby. He was telling me that. He never told me that before. He's still telling me that for the first time. I was gonna adopt his daughter's baby for her to go to college. She was 18. And I said, fine. If you don't want this baby, I'm gonna have this baby. I'm gonna go back to New York. I'm gonna have this baby. No, you don't understand. I don't want a baby, period. I don't want to have a baby. I said, why? Because I have to support my grandchild. And I said, okay, I'll support the child. That's not a problem. He said, you don't understand. I don't want a baby. Because sooner or later, you're going to ask me for money. You're going to ask me for child support. I don't want a baby. You can go back to New York if you want, but I don't want this baby. And then we got into, he grabbed me. He threw me in on bed and he grabbed my throat. I just defended myself. He was very angry. And I said to him, forget it. I'm not gonna have an abortion. And I said, he said, well, let me take a shower, leave the room. Let me take a shower. He had just arrived home. And we'll talk more in a little bit. So I left the room. He locked himself inside the bedroom. And he had the shower in the bedroom. And I didn't know what to do. Because before that, I had tried to commit suicide with sleeping pills. But he took away all my sleeping pills. I didn't have anything that would calm me down. But we had a bottle of caipirinha, which is
cachaça,
yes. Yeah. Because once we traveled to Brazil and we bought a bottle, I never drank before. But I thought of that. I said, maybe I should drink to calm myself down. I'll drink something while I have to work. I was anxious before while I have to wait for him to finish up his shower. So I start drinking and I had a gun. I bought a gun. But now I'm older.
No, you're on the right track. You're on the right track. But as you told him, if I'm recalling this correctly, you had bought the knee because you were going to try to commit suicide.
Yeah, but I didn't tell him that part yet.
Yeah, you did do it. So you buy the gun. Where do you buy the gun at?
No, let me say on Thursday, here's Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday was the day that he died, right? So, I think on Wednesday, I knew I was pregnant. I took the pregnancy, that week, I knew I was pregnant, took the pregnancy test. Maybe it was a few days before that. So I knew it was pregnant, but I didn't tell him. He was on his trips. Got home on Monday. So he one, two, three. I don't know if he was home that day. But I knew I was pregnant.
Wednesday of that week, you find out you're pregnant.
Between Monday and Thursday, between Monday and Thursday.
Sometime that week.
Yeah, I found out I was pregnant.
Okay.
But I didn't tell him because I was afraid. So I thought, if that man doesn't want me to have this child, I'm going to kill myself. Because I'm not going to have an abortion. So what did I do? There was a file on the internet called suicide.
You told me you found us on ways to commit suicide.
Yeah, between the years of between 2000 and 4 or 5, it was all over the news that people could get on the internet a file that would tell all kinds of step by step how. how you could commit suicide.
So you were searching the internet for possible ways to kill yourself?
Yeah, and that file is even saved on the hardware.
Okay.
On the hard drive, hard drive.
Okay.
And the best way of committing suicide was with the gun. But the downside of killing yourself with a gun is that it has a recoil. That most people that try to kill themselves, they lose part of their face, but they don't die. Because you aim here and the gun will do like that or like that, and you wind up not dying. But that's the most successful way of killing yourself. And then there's
you
jumping
found a way
up
around
the
building.
Right.
Well, what so tell me about that.
Yeah, then I thought that was, because there were other ways, poison, jumping off of a bridge, of a building, what do you call it, the heat, you leave on the gas, the stove on, many ways. So I thought gun was a good way because they had guns, they sold guns in Ohio. That would be easy, right? And not so painful. So what I did, but I had a problem. The recoil thing bothered me because if I just get my face ripped off and I don't die, I'm in worse place, right? So what I do, I went to the gun store, and I asked for a gun that was small enough for my hands, and I wanted it with the laser beam. Because I wanted to shoot to see what that recoil was. So they assembled it for me.
Do you remember the name of the gun shop or where it was?
It was not too far away from Newton Falls.
I said Slug Masters, would that sound about right?
Slug of Slugs. Yes. So they helped me to find the right gun for my hand. I have small hands. And I said, explain to me about this laser beam. Or I said, I don't want to buy a laser beam. Just sell me the whole package. So I bought the whole package, and I went to
Why do you want the laser beam?
Well, I'm going to explain that to you. I went to firing range, right? Because I want to shoot it to understand if I aim at that point, how much more above that point you would hit.
So you did a little research on this. I mean, obviously, you understood that there could be a point where the laser's hitting and the bullet's not hitting that exact spot. You researched this on the internet?
No. The beam came from my head. That was obvious.
You knew that there was a chance that bullet wouldn't hit exactly where the beam
was.
Yeah,
because the article said about the recoil.
Right, the article you were reading.
The article said about the recoil. So I was concerned about the recoil, so I had to understand about the recoil. I said, if I go to a shooting range, when I aim in that point, and if it shoots like inch above or 2 inches, I will know how much I have to adjust it. To lower it to hit where I want. So I I don't know how much ammunition I bought, but I was there for just 1 hour. And I became very good at it. It's not difficult.
It's not that hard.
So I was hitting the target, and I said, well, that's fine. That facing the gun that way, it's easy. What about facing the gun sideways? That's totally different. That's not gonna work.
How are you gonna see where the laser's hitting?
You see a little.
You do this. How do you see where the laser's hitting?
No, you didn't get it.
Yeah, because that's where I was fascinated when you told me about the thing.
The laser beam is not for killing myself. The laser beam was to understand the recoil. What is recoil?
She wanted to see if she pointed the gun.
If I pointed here, it will hit here. I would understand how much I would have. If I want to hit here, actually I have to aim here. So the laser beam was for me to understand what is recoil, what's the
get what you're saying.
Okay.
Not accurate, but I get what you're saying.
Makes sense. We understand.
You can't. Here's what I'll tell you. Because I can tell you this now. You can't control recoil. Okay?
But I only figured that out late after I did it.
Okay, she actually told me that she figured out that she couldn't figure
it
out.
We wouldn't.
I actually teach that stuff. That's why I was going to teach you real quick.
Right. So I said, that's not good. I just figured, I paid to learn that that won't work.
Right.
That won't work. That will be no good. So what I do?
But you found out you were a good shot in the process.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm an athlete. So I'm good with sewing. I'm very good with my hands. Mm-hmm. So I'm good firm hands. So that wasn't hard at all. Shooting is not hard. At least not from at a range. So what did I do? I said, yeah, that's very, very, very easy to shoot straight, but not sideways. Not gonna work. I don't know what's gonna happen with my hand. I cannot practice shooting that way. I can't. Yeah. So I went home, and my husband had tools to work with wood. He was an artist, but so I went there and I made a piece of wood. With a hole in the middle. And I think that I would screw that to a door frame. I went inside a closet. I did that in his daughter's room. I went inside a closet and I screwed that in there. I cut a piece of wood that would be the size of the opening, mm-hmm. right? And I screwed that here.
And you did that all yourself?
Yep. And I got a seat, and I measured that hole to be right here. So I measured it, and I screwed that in the frame. So I put a gun there. All I would have to do is pull the trigger to go right in here.
I don't have to worry about the recoil.
No recoil.
Did you find that on the internet, or you
No, I'm smart.
Can't do it yourself.
I'm not stupid.
Well, Chris, here's what I'm going to tell you. Mm-hmm. I'm going to sleep better tonight because for the last 11 years, I've been wanting to know exactly what that piece of wood was all about.
Yes.
No. Honestly, I have, that has baffled me for years.
No. Come on.
Yeah.
Not something we see every day.
But there's a chair right there.
Okay, let's get back. We'll talk about this again.
We'll go back to that.
Now I can sleep.
Okay. So my plan was never, not for one single minute, to kill anybody. But I swear to God, there was not for a single minute I thought about that. But that man was stupid enough when he saw me, when he came out of that bedroom, that he saw me. I was drunk. I waited for him for almost 1 hour.
Well, he's in the shower, you're drinking.
I'm drinking.
He gets out of the shower, comes out of the bedroom, what happens?
Then, with my coat on, a little bag in here, and a gun inside. I walk all over the place, drinking, and waiting, nervous for him to come out of the room. And, to shake him up about this pregnancy. So I know. I'll wait for him. When he opens the door, I'll be right here. Put it down to my head. So that's what I did. So when he opened the door and see me with a gun, he saw me with a gun to my head, he would have no reaction. He would keep staring at me. And all of a sudden, he doesn't move, and he grabs the gun and grabs my hand and keeps holding me, and then he just throws me against the wall. And I fell down because there was a door here. That was the door to the... Oh, you know the house. Mm-hmm. There's the door to the bedroom, and there's the door to a middle bedroom, right?
I'm trying to remember, but yes, I think I remember what you're saying.
And there's a third bedroom where is his bedroom. That's where I have the thing. And here's the third bedroom, which is where I have the...
And the steps are over here going down?
Yeah, the steps are right here.
Right, okay.
Right? So when he comes out of the room, I'm right there.
Come back over here so I can see it. My bright eyes, man.
Yeah, so, and he stares at me. I thought he would have some emotion to his face. Had no emotion to his face at all. Nothing. Just looked at me, and then he grabbed the gun in my arm at the same, no, and my neck at the same time. But then, he just threw me, and I fell. I hit my head against the door frame of that bedroom, middle bedroom, and I just stayed there. And we start talking, and he said, no, he started talking, he wasn't talking anymore. He said, that's a very good idea, but just do me a favor, let me leave the room and go to the basement to do that, because you're gonna splash my paintings. You're gonna splash blood all over my paintings, because down that step there were three paintings, and he's a collector of paintings. I got very angry. If he had said that, I would be dead, he would be alive.
What happened next?
Well, what happened next is that I got very angry and I got up real fast and I shot.
Shot what?
I shot at him, and I was lying down. He was going...
Come back over here, please. Please.
Yeah, I was lying down, right? I got up real fast. And I shot at him. He wasn't too far away. He was close.
Was he down the steps? Where was he?
He was going down the steps. Maybe he was on the third step. And it was here. Right?
You're right at the top of the steps. Top corner.
Yeah, the steps are here, right? Here's the door to the master bedroom. Here's the door to his son's bedroom. Here's the door to his daughter's bedroom.
Is there a bathroom over here somewhere, maybe?
There was a bathroom here, yes. He saw me here, then he threw me here. I hit my head here. I was here.
So when he threw you down, you didn't lose control of the gun or anything, or he didn't take it from you?
No, he didn't take it from me. So when he saw, when he said, paintings here, I got very angry. I got very angry. And if he had not said that, he would have lived, and I would have died. I would have killed myself.
So him telling you to go down there changed the whole...
Changed the whole thing.
Makes
it was
mad.
Very sensitive.
You're still mad, I can tell.
Yeah.
It's very emotional. And yeah. This is exactly what you told us when we were on the airplane. You're telling us now exactly the same thing that you told us before.
I said, look, I didn't say a word. I just thought it was too quick. I'm going to die. We're going to die. But you're going to die with us. The three of us, we're going to die here now.
You and the kid?
Yeah.
You and the baby?
Yes. But those were not words that I said. It was too quick.
Just what you were thinking.
Yeah, I thought and I acted, you know, real quick.
Can you stand up?
I got up real fast. I was maybe like just like this.
Yeah.
They just got up real fast. And
what'd you do next?
I just turned around. And I shot. My impression is that the gun had five shots because I had had a little drink. My feeling is that I had shot him three times and I saved two bullets for myself. So after I shot him, I ran inside this third bedroom. And I sat in the little chair. I sat in the little wheelchair. As hard as it was, I pulled the trigger. It was the hardest thing I ever done in my life. It was hard. I pulled the trigger, nothing happened. I said, my bullets. What happened? I pulled the trigger a second time. I don't know where I got this twin. Nothing happened. What happened? I shot him three times, and I sent two bullets for myself. And what happened? I got confused. So I said, "Let me put new bullets in. Maybe bad bullets. I don't know." So I ran downstairs to the basement. And I don't remember was when I was going down or going up, back up. I realized what I had done, and I tried to see if it was alive, breathing. I put my I took his phone before, or and I tried to see if it was breathing or vice versa. He wasn't. I said, I've got to finish up what I started. So, I think it was on my way down. Yes, it was on my way down. Then I said, no, it's done. I gotta finish up what I started. I went to the basement, put in five new bullets in the gun. I went back to the room, his daughter's room. I put that gun in that piece of wood. I sat there again. But it was hard because I started thinking about my family. And I said, let me say goodbye to my family. Let me tell my family what I did and what I'm going to do with myself. I don't want them to find that out through the newspapers. I want myself to tell them. So from the landline, I called my sister. From the cell phone, I called my father. And somehow they start talking among themselves, and they call some lawyer, and they said that Ohio had a death penalty, and they advised my father and my sister to convince me to leave the U.S., but they hadn't told me that. In the meantime, while my father and my sister are talking, they put my sister's husband on the phone talking to me, and he's a pastor, and he started talking to me about hell, going to hell. Don't do that, don't kill yourself, because you're going to hell, da da da. He didn't say anything about death penalty, they only talked about going to hell. And he said, no, I don't want to hear that about hell, I gotta kill myself, I wanna die. They said, no, don't do that. And then my father took the phone and he said, do you know where your passport is? I said, yes, I do. Where is it? I said, it's the bank. It's in a safe in a bank. And do you have money? I said, I have a credit card and I have $1,300. In my bank account. He said, go there, get money, and get your passport, and you're gonna come to Brazil. I said, I can't drive, I'm drunk. And they have coffee in the house. I said, I do. Make strong coffee and drink coffee that you're gonna come back. I said, I can't. So he convinced me to do that. I went to the bank, went to the safe deposit, that is only under my name. My husband didn't have access to that. It's only under my name. So I
where was that bank at, Chris?
Beautiful.
Remember the name of the bank?
Up yeah.
Maybe Huntington? Would have been Huntington at the time.
I don't remember what they were.
I'm trying to remember.
I think it's HSBC.
There's
only one bank in Newark.
Yeah, I know it. Okay. Yeah, it just may have changed names over the years, that's all.
It's only one bank in there. So take deposit box, which I had when I got married to him. I had $40,000 in cash. Why I had that? Because I claimed bankruptcy and I couldn't keep my money in the bank. So, but I spent $30,000 because it didn't work for a while, and I was buying food for the house, I was buying clothes, we were traveling, you know, I paid for all meals, going out to dinner. So I spent $30,000 easily. Over 2 years, I spent $30,000. So but I still have $10,000. So, no. I didn't have, that day, I didn't have the $10,000 anymore. Because on Thursday, when I decided to kill myself, when I was prepared to kill myself, I said, I have $10,000. If I'm going to kill myself, I'm not going to leave this $10,000 to him. I'm going to give it to my father. So on Thursday, I transferred $10,000 to my father. If I was...
Did you call him to tell me we were going to do that, or did he know that money came?
I did that once in a while because I support family members. Once in a while, I don't remember if I told him. I probably did. But he was...
Did you tell him why, or that was just normal?
No.
Was that a bigger transfer than...
But I wasn't sure if I was going to kill myself. Was just in case I killed myself, because I hadn't talked to him. I was hoping that on Monday we would straighten things out.
Well, would that have wired that money back to you if you wanted it?
No.
So you were out 10 grand one way or the other?
No, that money was for my sister. Okay. You know, that money was money that I gave often to my sister. So
you were giving your last money you were giving away to your sister?
Well, but you know, it would go to good use, because instead of me wiring money every couple months, every 3 months, every 6 months, that money would last a year, you know, to support my sister. So I wired that money to him just in case things didn't work out on Monday, because it was the day he was coming back home, and I was going to tell him about the pregnancy. So that day, I wired the money. If I was planning... airplane ticket, which I didn't. I bought the airplane ticket in New York on Monday afternoon. We were confused when I got to the bank to get the things out of the safe deposit box. That I thought, my God, I have $1,300 in the bank account. If I clean it up, they will know that I killed my husband. I was paranoid. So I only got $1,000 and left $300 in the bank account that is still there to this date. And I was confused, I was paranoid. So I went to the to the clerk, and I got $1,000 out in cash, and I got the things out of my safe deposit box, which was my passport and my my diplomas from school and birth certificate. Documents, and the money was not there anymore because I had transferred it on Thursday. But on this Monday, after I killed him, I went to the bank and I got my stuff. If I was planning on doing this, I would have gotten things out of the safe deposit box before I killed him, not after.
I understand.
Right?
I know where you're going with this.
Right. So, my father encouraged me, go there, get your stuff in. And you're going to fly to Brazil. I don't know. It's a long trip from New York to Pittsburgh, which was the airport. And I'm going to help you out. And I'm going to try to buy you the ticket with my credit card. But if things don't work out, at least you have $1,000 and you have your credit card, you're going to be able to get a ticket. So I was able to get a ticket.
Getting it? saying, yeah, what you told me earlier was when you left the bank, you drove to...
Oh, yeah, I left
very slow and very careful.
Very, I was like a zombie. I was, my father was talking to me to try to encourage me, so I, because I didn't even know why I was driving. My life is over. What's the purpose of me doing this? But one thing kept going through my head. I want to say goodbye to my family. I want to see my family. Because that idea of committing suicide hadn't left my head yet. I thought, if I get to Brazil and I say goodbye to my family, I still can kill myself. And I tried to kill myself there that day that I got to
And how did you try to do that?
I went to a very expensive hotel in Copacabana. I went to the highest, I think it was 19th floor, to the highest apartment that I could get, and I had a credit card. And I said, give me the most, that was all the limit I still had left in my credit card. So I went down and I said goodbye to my father. He picked me up at the airport. I talked to him. I told him, listen, I did this horrible thing, and I don't want to be in your house because I don't want to involve you in something like that. Because we thought that if the police found me in his house, he would be arrested. That's not true, but at the time, we didn't know how things work. So I said, I'm not going to get you involved in this. I just want to say goodbye. We cried and said goodbye. And he said, what are you going to do? I said, I'm not going to tell you. Where you go? I'm not going to tell you. But from the way I spoke to him, he knew I was playing, I'm doing. And I said, don't try to stop me. I had to do this. So we cried and we said goodbye. And I went into this very expensive hotel room, and what I was gonna do is that I was gonna sleep a little bit and then wait until night, because I didn't want to make a very bad scene, and I figured that at night I wouldn't have the risk of falling on top of someone and killing an innocent person. So I waited, and once I got to the room, I called my father. I said, Dad, I'm fine. I'm in a hotel room in Copacabana. I said, I love you, something like that. Fine. Then I went to sleep because it was still afternoon. Half an hour later, the phone rings in the room, and it's my father. I said, not gonna get into trouble by having you in my house. You can come with me. And I said, Dad, no, yeah, and we're gonna take care of you. I said, really? And my father was not very loving. Was never very loving. It was my. He said, you're my daughter. When he said that, my father never said that to me, those words. You're my daughter, and I love you.
Thank you.
right, Chris?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm fine.
All right, we're back. I got my coffee. All right, I started the tape back up. The time's 11:21. We took a short break. You're still ready to talk to us. You're still okay with talking to us. All right. Now, here's what I'm going to ask you. You laid out quite a story for us.
Yeah, there's still a big part, an important part of it.
Well, that's what I was going to ask.
Attempt on suicide before, a month before he died.
You did?
Yeah, he committed to the mental hospital. He put me there.
How did you try to do that that time?
Well, thing is, he was depressed. I told him he was depressed. He was drinking a lot. He was having problems with his job at Southwest. He was not flying well, and he was getting bad reviews, and he was at risk of losing his job. So he was already depressed over several things. He was hadn't gotten over his divorce from his first wife. It was piling up on him because he wanted to become a politician, and his dreams were ruined. Then the law, not having custody of his children, he was very frustrated because they were fat. And they wanted to be skinny, and they were not, because he wanted his son to be a sports boy, and he was a computer type of person who wanted to play games, and he didn't work out. He was fat, and his daughter was also fat. There was a problem with him. He wanted the perfect wife, the perfect house, perfect kids. He was obsessed with them. Things were getting out of hand. Left his his first marriage didn't work out. His second marriage with Carla Del Castillo, the Peruvian woman, didn't work out. And he was obsessed with her because he talked about her all the time with me. It was crazy. And I looked like her. That's why he married me. And made me even dye my hair black because he wanted me to look like her.
Right.
And then his son left, didn't want to be living with him anymore. And then there was the pregnancy thing, and Southwest. All those things start piling up in his head. He became depressed. Oh, and there was the thing that he thought he had prostate cancer, and he tried to get money from military?
The
Air Force, and they denied his retirement and denied the settlement. So you can also check those records.
Something we didn't touch on, I think probably just because you got emotional at the time. After you shot him, you were pregnant. What happened with that child?
I lost the baby.
You lost that baby.
I couldn't eat. I didn't eat. I didn't sleep in Brazil. I was very sick.
Was that while you were in Sao Paulo at your father's? Sao Paulo?
No, my father. I landed in Sao Paulo. From Sao Paulo, I went to Rio.
Okay.
I stayed with my father for like, I guess, 4 days.
Okay.
And then from Rio, I went to Brazil, and I didn't leave anymore.
When you lost the baby in Brazil, did you go to a hospital there or a doctor?
No, because I was afraid to give my name and be arrested. I was paranoid for that.
Okay. And we're going to talk about some of that, too, because I'm really, really interested in what happened after. Right, I'd like to know how all that worked. Another question. At some point, did you try to buy, now you told us about the revolver. At some other point, did you try to buy another gun with you?
Yeah, I tried to buy another gun.
Tell me why, or what it was, or where you tried to buy it. Or tell me everything.
I thought that gun was not, I don't remember exactly
one. That was a 45, if I remember right.
Yeah, I think he convinced me that, I don't remember the
reason. Who convinced you?
The guy at the firing
at the range
store, yes.
What, he was trying to tell you that that might be a better gun for you or something?
No, I started inquiring.
Because of internet searches you were doing?
Yes.
Okay, so you actually tried to buy it, just that the purchase didn't go through on your credit card, right? Do you remember?
No, I think I figured that first gun, it was good. It was a good gun. I didn't need that other gun. It was good.
Okay, so, all right. I thought something happened to your credit card didn't go through or something. Maybe I'm mistaken. Like I said, it's been a long time.
I don't remember.
Okay, that's
fine.
It's minor. I was trying to figure out why you needed two guns.
No, I think, to be honest with you, I don't remember why I wanted to buy the second gun if I thought that one would be more efficient than the other. And, or maybe because I shot with a gun similar to that gun and I thought it was better. Oh, wait a minute. Yeah, I think I tried that gun and I thought it was a good gun. It was like...
How'd you try it?
I think he let me fire with a similar gun.
So somebody at the range let you shoot once, and you liked it, so you were going to buy one.
The fuel. I thought it was...
Did it have anything to do with any kind of... Do you remember having any conversations with anybody about, like, knockdown power or anything like that?
What is that knockdown power?
You know, like the power of the bullet? Like what it would take to actually put somebody down if they were, you know, if you're trying to shoot them? Do you recall any of that?
All I remember is that when I went to buy the bullet, I wanted to buy that bullet that exploded.
Hollow point?
I don't know the name of it, but that opened.
Why do you want that?
Because if I want to kill myself, I wanted it to not to just go, not do any harm, to do big harm.
And you were buying that gun for what reason? Tell me again. Why were you buying the gun in the first place?
The first one?
Mm-hmm.
To kill myself. Yeah. That's why I made that hole in the wood.
All right. Now, you were very descriptive in what you
made. Remember why I want to buy a second gun.
Well, it may have, as you're talking about that, some of that stuff's kind of sparked in my memory and made me think that maybe you did shoot something at the range and somebody, but I thought there was something about maybe, you know, a bigger bullet, more knockdown power. I thought I remember hearing something about that, but I could be mistaken.
Oh, the only thing I remember was that I wanted to buy a bullet that would do more harm or open inside your body to do more damage.
And where'd you learn that about that at?
Carl.
Oh, he told you about the bullets?
Yeah, he told
me. Did he teach you how to shoot? I mean, did he?
Yeah, he shot in the house. He taught me how to shoot. Help me out.
Like a long gun, a shotgun?
Yeah, shotgun.
Okay. Did he have handguns in the house?
Lots, yes.
So why did you go buy, if you had...
Because I tried to commit suicide several times. You didn't let me get into that yet.
No, what I'm saying though is if he had guns in the house,
why did he... Because I tried to kill myself with the gun, and then when he found out, he took away all the guns from the house.
Okay. How'd you fail? How did you not kill yourself?
I got scared. I changed my mind, but I told him that I tried to do that.
Right.
And after that...
No problem. Now, I want to go back to, you remember very vividly, you kind of drew out the layout of upstairs for us. I mean, you're pointing the gun in the direction that you thought you would have been pointing it back then. How many times, so he comes out of the bathroom, and I just want to replay this, because this is we'll touch on a lot of different things here, but this is nuts and bolts of it.
Yeah.
You're drinking. You're upset because he doesn't want you to have, now he knows you're pregnant for the third time. He doesn't want you to have that baby. He says, I'm taking a shower, we'll talk about it. So you're going to make an impact. You want him to see that you're serious about this when he comes out of that room.
Yeah.
And you're standing there with that gun to your head. He comes out.
stares at you for a few seconds.
Faze him.
Not only does it not faze him, once he tosses you on the ground, he says what?
Go ahead.
Just don't mess up my stuff.
Yeah.
Because my stuff's more important than you. Right?
Yeah, you need to take it like that, but this is a quid.
You bounce up off the ground.
Yeah.
After he shoves you down, what's his action after that? Does he start going down the steps?
No, the first bullet knocked him.
What's that?
The first bullet knocked him.
Knocked him?
Knocked. Killed him. The first one.
The first one killed him?
The first one. He fell down. He was going down the stairs. Like this. Like in his one foot. I remember his one foot did like this. He fell down. But there was not that sound like.
Now, you had a laser on that gun.
No, but it was so, I didn't need to use because it was too fast. The laser was not for, I didn't buy a gun to kill anybody.
I'm not saying you did.
So the laser beam was there was no more use for it. It was just in the gun.
Now listen to what I'm saying. Mm. Do you know where that first shot hit him?
No, I actually, I was just shooting.
That's why I'm asking you, because the laser, obviously if you have a laser pointing somewhere, it's hard to see where a bullet actually hit something, but it's pretty easy to see where that red laser's pointing.
No, it was too fast. It's impossible to.
How close was he to you when you fired that first shot?
From here to there, or less. From here to there.
So I would say at most this is six and a half feet,
yeah.
Feet maybe?
Yeah.
So very close.
Very close.
Okay. And then how many times did you shoot?
In my head, I had shot him 3 times, but the articles say I shot 5 times, hit him 3 bullets, and 2 were hit the room.
And we'll get into that.
But in my head, I had shot him 3 times, and I saved up 2 bullets for myself.
Okay, we'll get into that, because that touches on that. We're going to do a little math problem here. I know you're intelligent, so we're going to work on that math here.
I don't know if it's true that there were 5 shots. I read that on the internet.
If I remember what you told me on the plane, if I remember correctly, you said that it happened so fast that you shot, and you remember shooting a couple times, but you just don't, you didn't remember how many, because when you went to the bedroom, you thought you had 2 more bullets.
No.
When you tried.
In my head, I counted the 3 bullets.
You counted 3.
In my head, I counted 3 bullets.
Right.
So in my head, I knew there were 5, so less 3, there's still 2.
Okay.
So went to the bed. I only needed 1 to kill myself, but I had 2. Because in my head, I
All right, we're going to get back to that. But so he shot 3 times.
In my head, I don't know if I hit him or not.
Okay.
In my head,
the first shot, you know, I mean, you
in the first shot, I know hit him because I saw how he fell.
And you said you know it killed him. He went right down, his foot buckled. You're describing how his foot buckled.
No, it looked like, it looked like the first one was the bullet that killed him from the way he didn't make a sound. That's what I think happened.
Now, regardless of the number of shots you actually fired or what you think you read or what have you, where did you fire? Did you fire all the shots from upstairs, or did you go down to where he was at the bottom of the steps?
Don't remember.
And shoot more?
Don't remember that part. Happened too fast.
Because one thing I'm going to tell you, I'm going to let out, which you probably read on. Do you remember reading anything on the news about the coroner's report?
I read a few things.
Do you remember anything about a contact gunshot wound?
No, I don't know.
Do you understand what a contact gunshot wound is with all the research you've done about suicide and other
contact?
Things? Contact.
Must be contacts when. Yeah.
In close proximity, very close.
Yeah.
He had one of
those. It's possible that I hit him know that I shot him two more times, but I don't remember if it was on top or if I went down to shoot him. Okay. I don't remember, but it's possible that I did.
Possible that you did?
Yes, it's possible.
So it's not out of the realm of possibility?
No, it's not.
Because what could have happened there, I mean, you're mad, right? I mean, basically, he just told you that his paintings are more important than you.
Yeah, yeah.
So you're pissed.
Yes.
And I think most people would be at that.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
So, we hit him, he goes down, you get on the bottom of the steps. Is he still moving? Is he still breathing?
No, he was already not moving because he didn't make that sound of, you know, nothing. So, it was too fast. It's like I'm saying, I don't remember if I went down and shot two more times or if I shot from the top of the seat. That part I don't remember. But I know I shot three times. That's what I remember. I may have shot five, but I only remember three.
So it's possible. Anyway.
And it's very possible that I shot five times because I told you that I went back to the room.
You went to the bedroom.
To shoot at myself and nothing happened.
Mm-hmm.
So I was baffled. I was confused because in my head I had shot three times.
Not five.
But
it would make sense that you shot five because when you pulled
the
trigger twice, nothing happened.
Right. I got very confused. So I don't have that much experience with guns. And I thought, the bullets are bad. Maybe they failed. There was a problem. There was a manufacturing problem with the bullets. So I gotta go back to the basement and change the bullets, put new bullets in to go back and kill myself. But in the meantime, I think it's when I'm going down, I don't remember if it was going down or up the stairs, and I had came, oh, it was when I was going up because of where it was already cold. And then I came to my sense. I think that time of going down to the basement and having time to put in five new bullets, I came to my senses. And when I went up again and I saw him there, and I realized what I had done, and I took up his pulse and checked his breathing.
What did you do next?
When I saw that he was not breathing at all, I went running back into the bedroom to shoot myself a third time. That was when it was the reason why I didn't shoot myself the third time was not because it was hard, it was because I thought of my family.
I got you. Makes sense.
Yeah.
I get you.
I wanted to tell them.
Now, he was covered up. Why'd you cover him up?
See, yes, because when I went back. No, I didn't go back to the house. I went straight from the bank to the airport. I didn't go back into the house because I wanted to have time to find. So I put a cover over him and a letter in case somebody came to the window, they would not see his body. So I would have time to take him in.
To get out of the country.
To get out of the country.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
I would jump in with something about the airport. This is something I'm curious about because it confused me. Why didn't you just... I know there isn't like a direct flight from Pittsburgh to Brazil, but why didn't...
There isn't.
But I was just curious, why did you fly from Pittsburgh to LaGuardia and then, like, you changed airports? There wasn't a way to book a flight, and like when I flew down there a couple days ago when I went to get you, they didn't let us fly down on that really nice plane.
No, the
we had to fly on American, we had to go to Miami and change planes, but we were able to do it right from here.
No, listen, there were no flights at that time from Pittsburgh to JFK.
Okay, so that was the only way to get there. You had to go to LaGuardia.
Yeah.
And
they are really five minutes
they're
away.
Close. Yeah, I'm familiar. You used to live there.
Yeah, and I got there, I don't know, probably 2, I don't know, before 2 p.m. around.
Okay.
because it was only 6 at night. So I had plenty of time.
4 hours and...
I wasn't in a rush to get to JFK. I was in a rush to get to New York because the flight to Brazil was from New York.
Okay. So that's probably not uncommon to fly to LaGuardia and then just have to get a cab or a friend
and
or somebody.
I didn't have money for the... for the ticket, I had to fly with his flying privileges.